usual. Well, I will go for the third speaker, which is a brilliant lecturer as well. It's Dr. Khalda Radwan. She is the former head of chairman of anesthesia department in Theodor Bilharz Research Institute. And she's currently the head of quality assurance unit at the Theodor Bilharz Research Institute as well. She's a trainer in the Egyptian Anesthesia Fellowship and a member in many of local Egyptian anesthesia society. She's a reviewer of loads, and she has published loads of publications. I was honored to read some of them and to cite some of them as well. And she's going to talk to us about a very important lecture. It's a very important topic, which is the post-operative anesthesia care, and that will affect a lot in the outcome of anesthesia and surgery as well. Dr. Khalda?
Many thanks, Dr. Amr, for this introduction. I'll share start our subject today. First, I have to declare that I have no conflict of interest. We will talk about what about after surgery. The anesthetist its role is intraoperative. What about postoperative? What about postoperative care? What he is doing for postoperative care of patients? It is postoperative. It is really a postoperative work, or it is started a little bit before that. Our introduction, which is about what were we are talking about. We will talk about the postoperative care. Well, it depends upon the type of the surgery and the health history of the patients. It actually starts preoperatively. Our concerns postoperatively will be about the problems we are facing, which are usually pain management, nausea and vomiting, regional and epidural catheters. Our concern postoperative is to discharge the patient home safely. Firstly, we will talk about pain control. It is the most serious complaint of the patient postoperative is the pain. It is a cornerstone of our practice. Provision of effective analgesia is essential for optimal patient recovery after surgery. In spite of that, about nearly 20% of the patients experience severe pain in the first 24 hours after surgery, which must be declined after that. Postoperative pain continues to be poorly managed in clinical practice, will lead to chronic pain. Pain management can be pharmacological intervention and non-pharmacological intervention. Pharmacological, that means that we are dealing with drugs. The drugs used may be either intravenous or regional or epidural or peripheral injection or peripheral injections. We respect the prospect recommendations, which is a procedure-specific postoperative pain management. It is an international collaboration of anesthesiologists and surgeons providing a practical procedure-specific pain management recommendations. However, this needs to be tailored to each patient separately, according to additional factors such as comorbidities, pre-existing analgesics, pharmacogenetics, or drug interactions or intolerance, or drug intolerance. Recommendations they gain from the prospects depend upon the evidence-based systematic reviews of different literatures. The risk of benefits of the interventions is a specific surgical setting. Use of intervention is a context of multimodal non-opioid analgesic strategies. Modern perioperative care pathways. The use of multimodal analgesia or multimodal regimen is to be recommended. Multimodal pain management means that we use different anesthetic agents or techniques to get rid of pain. Our control pain. Systemic pharmacological, some of the drugs used for IV or oral is acetaminophen, which is limited side effect, has limited side effects. It is the last to be stopped. Its maximum dose will be 4 grams per day. from all sources. It is regularly used to decrease the narcotic effects. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory, it is another type of the pharmacological drugs used. They have inflammatory, anti-inflammatory effects. They omit it if they have side effects. They may be produce renal affections or produce bleeding tendency or gastric upset. At that time, we have to abort the drugs. There is a selective cyclooxygenase two inhibitors, which are currently used in clinical practice. They are a good anti-inflammatory drugs, have analgesic, antiviratic effects with gastrointestinal safety, not like the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory. Magnesium sulfate was also thought to have an opioid sparing effect, can be used preoperatively and continued postoperatively, can be given by a bolus in the form of 30 to 50 milligram per kg or by an infusion, which can extend for 6 hours or even more, can extend to for 48 hours even postoperatively. Intravenous magnesium extends the duration of sensory block in some into small studies, clinical trials, in fact, when given with a spinal anesthesia. Intravenous lidocaine also claimed to have an anti, analgesic effect. Suggested dose at induction to be 1.5 milligram per kg and followed by infusion 2 milligram per kg per hour intraoperatively. Multimodal analgesia may be used intravenous or axial, neuroaxial therapies. They are the form of thoracic or abdominal, that can be used for thoracic or abdominal epidurals or spinal anesthesia, which is a neuroaxial therapist. These the techniques can be used in certain patients with high risk, such as cardiac patients with complications or with pulmonary complications or prolonged AVS. They have the advantages that they can introduce a catheter, which has a prolonged analgesic effect postoperative. They decrease the risk of postoperative venous thromboembolism, decrease the risk of myocardial infarction, pneumonia, and respiratory depression, and decrease the duration of the AVS versus systemic analgesia. Peripheral regional anesthesia is another technique can be used with supplement with intravenous drug administration. Peripheral regional anesthetic techniques is a component of the multimodal. Continuous local anesthetic based peripheral regional analgesic techniques is recommended when the need of analgesia is likely to exceed the duration of effect of single injection. We can introduce a catheter and introduce the anesthetic, local anesthetic. Local and topical pharmacological therapies, subcutaneous or intra-articular infiltration or local incision infiltration of long-acting local anesthetics act at the site of the surgery is a component of a multimodal analgesia in several surgical procedures with a very good outcome. The use of topical local anesthetics in combination with nerve blocks before circumcision is noted. We will discuss about several subjects according to a prospect and the drugs used. They didn't talk about gabapentin, which is also a good analgesic, can be used with opioid preserving effect, aspirin effect. For the management of the pain or postoperative pain after elective cesarean section, the preoperative, we have to know that we have to start the pain management preoperatively. We put our when we put our anesthetic plan, we have to consider the pain management all through the procedure. We start pre-emptive before surgery, maybe oral administration of certain drugs, maybe just IV injections before induction of anesthesia, and used another drugs intraoperatively and continue postoperatively. May use anesthetic techniques, just like in cesarean section, we use epidural and spinal anesthesia, which we can introduce the local anesthetic drugs intraoperative and continue postoperative with a little doses of local anesthetics with opioids, which may make the patient walkable and prevent the complications of the local anesthetics. For the cesarean section, use by prospect, they recommend the use of oral gabapentin preoperatively, use of spinal anesthesia or epidural analgesia intraoperatively, together with paracetamol or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory, wound infiltration with local anesthetics or tab blocks or iliolumbilical or hypogastric blocks. Surgical technique, we have to use an incision, a transverse incision or non-closure of the peritoneum will decrease the risk of the pain and decrease its intensity. Post-operative, you can use oral paracetamol and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory. Systemic opioids can be used as a rescue medication. Continuous wound infusion with local anesthetics can be used to decrease pain. As regards pain management after post-laparoscopic cholecystectomy, there is also a pre-operative medications with paracetamol, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory, COX-2 inhibitors, and oral gabapentin, not recommended. Dexamethasone is a line of treatment to be used pre-operatively and give an analgesic, remarkable analgesic effects, and beside its anti-emetic effects. Intraoperative, if not given preoperatively, paracetamol can be given, and non-steroid anti-inflammatory also can be given. We can use tab block and post-operative in intraperitoneal local anesthetics care to be taken if both sites used to avoid potential toxicity. In operative technique, we have to consider in the laparoscope certain precautions to guard against the pain. The pain after laparoscopic cholecystectomy is a specific pain related to the accumulation of gases under diaphragm, which make an irritation, diaphragmatic irritation related to a shoulder pain, which is a severe pain unbearable to the patients in spite of its small incision, which is done by the lab surgery of the ports of the labs. We have to introduce a low pressure insufflation of the CO2, use 10 to 20 millimeter mercury, saline lavage followed by the suction to suction all the gases remains, aspiration of the pneumoperitoneum, many ports reduce the port size. Postoperative, we can give oral paracetamols, oral non-steroidal anti-inflammatory or COX-2 selective inhibitor, rescue analgesics with opioids orally if possible. Also, for pharmacological medications, we you can use alpha-2 agonists or, but it is no more used now in certain situations because of the side effects of hypotension and complications. With radical prostatectomy, we all use preoperative oral COX-2 selective inhibitors with paracetamol or with or without gabapentin with dexamethasone. Parenteral intraoperative, we can use COX-2 also and intravenous lidocaine infusion, which continued in the postoperative period. We can use muscarinic receptor antagonists. For postoperative pain, if the vas is more than 50 millimeter, this is a severe pain. A COX-2 selective inhibitors with paracetamol with or without gabapentin and intravenous patient control analgesia of small doses of opioids. Moderate to low intensity pain, less than 50, the COX inhibitors with paracetamol and with or without gabapentin or opioid according to the response of the patient. For colorectal surgery, regional anesthesia is recommended for such procedures. Thoracic epidural, it is the main line of treatment. If contraindicated, we can proceed to COX-2 inhibitors, pre-medication, use of intravenous lidocaine started pre-incision and continued intra and postoperatively, but it is the most accepted or considered line of management will be a thoracic epidural with local anesthetic with supplement of opioids, with or without general anesthesia. Operative technique must be horizontal or curved incisions, we used a diathermy incision, which decreased the pain. Even local infiltrations of the wound incision will be considered to be before the surgery. Before the making of the incision, we infiltrate the local anesthetics before the incision is done. Pre-closure wound infiltration can be used, but it is better to do it before incision. Multimodal rehabilitation protocols, thoracic epidural analgesia, and Cox inhibitors with paracetamol. For thoracotomy, also regional anesthesia is recommended, which is a paravertebral block. It is the main way of management. As we say, the multimodal effects of regional anesthesia, either with epidural with a catheter or a local nerve block with a catheter or wound infiltration with some drugs preoperatively, continued intraoperatively, may decrease the dose or the requirements and of opioids postoperatively because they have a sparing effects of the opioids. There is another mode of interventions to treat pain postoperatively, which is a non-pharmacological. Non-pharmacological is a cheap and easy way to implement. It is about psychological and educational of the patients about the interventions, such as cognitive behavioral therapy, distraction techniques, just like music, aromatherapy, which is the use of aromatic oils, or they relieve pain just by in local or topical on the skin, essential oils. Canine therapy, which is used bits with presence of dogs, make patients pain intolerance more better than other patients with a virtual reality and the use of simulation by computer or something. This as regard pain management, which is a major problem. It represents about 20% of the cases, and we can handle it properly to avoid chronic pain. The other problem we have faced post-operatively is nausea and vomiting. Nausea and vomiting is the two common, most common adverse events which occurs postoperatively. The incidence is about 30% for general populations and about 80% in risk patients with high patients with high risk. It is a highly distressing experience with significant patient dissatisfaction. Make a longer stay in the BACU, unanticipated hospital readmission in some cases, and increase the costs of the healthcare. What is the risk factors? There is many risk factors that elicited here as regard gender, female patients, age, smoking or not, duration of the surgery, postoperative opioids need, volatile anesthetics, history of nausea and vomiting or sickness. All these risk factors are and a risk of the surgery. Surgery will be either type of the surgery and or duration of the surgery. This figure represents enter at the cost of the risk factors, and the size of each segment is proportional to the odds ratios of postoperative nausea and vomiting associated with each risk factors. It is mainly with the gender and the type of the surgery and in smokers and also the duration of surgery. Risk factors, there is positive risk factors which is established and known by many authors and many trials or many studies. Female sex, a history of postoperative nausea and vomiting or motion sickness, in non-smoking, a younger age, general versus regional anesthesia, and use of volatile anesthetics and the nitrous, postoperative opioids, a duration of anesthesia used, type of surgery, whether cholecystectomy or laparoscopic, gynecological, they have a higher incidence of nausea and vomiting. There is another risk factors which are conflicting, not established, like as a physical status, a menstrual cycle, if the patient is menstruating, a level of anesthetist experience, and muscle relaxants antagonists. There is another risk factor, this approved by many of the anesthetists, which is the body mass index, anxiety, nasogastric tube, supplemental oxygen, preoperative fasting, and migraine. Risk factors done by Apfel et al. Before, we consider the four major categories of the risk factors, which is a female gender, non-smoker, history of postoperative nausea and vomiting, the use of opioids postoperatively. The sum will be four. We calculate it is there is no risk factors, it represents about 10% of the cases. With one risk factor, it is 20% of the cases. The presence of two risk factors, it is about 40% of the cases, which is a double of the presence of one. If three, it is 30%. If 84, it is 80%. Let's say the more the risk factors, that the more will be the incidence of the nausea and vomiting. We have to interfere aggressively for the management of such patients. There is another for children for postoperative vomiting, because nausea cannot be estimated thoroughly in children. Risk factors may be in children, surgery before, then duration of surgery is more important, more than 30 minutes. In age of the patients, which is more than 3 years of old, some type of surgeries, such as strabismus surgeries or eye surgeries, a history of in the family for postoperative nausea and vomiting. These are the risk factors in children, which is done by Eberhardt et al., which is simplifying a score, making a score for such patients from 0 to 4. Still, if there is no risk factors, it is 10%. If there is one, it is also 10%, approximately the incidence of postoperative nausea and vomiting. If it is two, it is 30%. If it is four, it is, if it is three, it is 50%. If it is four, it is 70%. We have to make strategies to decrease the baseline risk, because we have found that the more the risk for me, the more the incidence of postoperative nausea and vomiting. We have to avoid the use of general anesthetic by and replace it by the regional anesthesia. Use propofol in the induction and maintenance of anesthesia better than the inhalation anesthetics. The nitrous oxide must be avoided in surgeries lasting over more than 1 hour. Avoidance of volatile anesthetics, as we said, minimizing an intra or postoperative opioids intake, adequate hydration of the patients, and using psychomedics instead of neostigmine for the reversal of neuromuscular blockade, found to have a safe preserving effect for the postoperative nausea and vomiting. This is the way from the consensus, force consensus guidelines for the management of postoperative nausea and vomiting. Considering the risk factors for the patients, how to minimize it by decreasing the use of nitrous oxides and considering regional anesthesia. When two factors, risk factors are present, we have to give two agents. If it is more than two, we have to give 3 to 4 agents. Prophylaxis is better than cure. We have to give a prophylaxis just as 5-hydroxytryptamine receptors antagonists, corticosteroids, antihistaminics, dopamine antagonist, propofol anesthesia better than inhalation anesthetic. Neurokinin 1 receptor antagonist, acupuncture, and anticholinergics. Rescue treatment will be a class, if we consider rescue medication, we have to do to introduce one which is not given in the prophylaxis. If we use two or three fill before, we have to use another group of drugs. For the pediatric patients, there is also a risk factor of the patients as regarding the age, the history of the family for the postoperative nausea and vomiting, and history of the family as regard homesickness. Post-pubertal females, intraoperative strabismus surgery, and adenoid surgery or adenoid tonsillectomy. surgery duration more than 30 minutes, use of volatile anesthetics, and use of anticholine esterases. This is a mistake here. There's the anticholine esterase, risk factor, post-operative long-acting opioids. We participate or anticipating post-operative nausea and vomiting. For risk stratifications, we with no risk, there is no medication to be given. If there is one risk, one or two risk factors, it is a medium risk. With three factors or more, it is a high risk. Prophylaxis is better than cure. We in low risk groups, none of the antiemetic drugs will be used, or we can use the 5-hydroxytyramine antagonist or dexamethasone. For the medium risk, we have to use them both. 5-hydroxytryptamine, 3, and the dexamethasone. For the high risk, we have to consider 3 elements for the management, which is the 5-hydroxytryptamine, dexamethasone, and the Ativa, propofol for anesthesia or propofol infusion. The rescue medication, as we said before, just droperidol or acupuncture, and of course consensus of doses that we can use. The timing is very important for the administration of the drugs to get that induction, and another to drugs not in their propping timing. For example, granisetron and ondansetron, if we use it preoperatively or the beginning of the surgery or with induction, at induction, they will give no effects. I will give the, we have to consider the proper timing to introduce the proper antiemetic drugs to be used. Pharmacological combination therapy, we said that to the risk factors, we use either level of the risks recommended by the forced consensus of guidelines for robust operative nausea and vomiting, 5-hydroxytryptamine receptors with dexamethasone, with ondansetron. This very very recommended doses. Another type hydroxy with antagonist with apri, betalutant, ondansetron, and ramucirumab. Can be used. There is another, this is the combinations can be used with ondansetron, with dexamethasone, hydrobidazolam can be used. This can be for the children, the use of ondansetron with the dexamethasone is the first line of choice for the treatment of the patient for postoperative vomiting. According to the risk score, this is APFIL score. According to the score of APFIL, we use, if there is no, we can give ondansetron 4 milligram. If it is more one risk factors, it is ondansetron 4 with or without dexamethasone. If two, we have to give two drugs, ondansetron with dexamethasone, post 4 milligram. If three, we have to give three drugs, ondansetron with dexamethasone with propofol infusion. For drugs, we have for risk factors, we have to give four drugs with add a scopolamine patch. The third concern of postoperative is the presence of catheter, either epidural catheter or a regional catheter from a nerve block or local anesthetic wound incision. We with a catheter for local anesthetic administration. Delivery of anesthetics and local analgesics and local anesthetic via a variety of catheter techniques used in procedures, including epidural infusion pumps, continuous peripheral nerve catheters. What the catheter? How we can deal with it? The deal is start before surgery. We have to put a plan and for the care of the patients before surgery with the involvement of the patients. We have to give a patient offer information about the type of pain, the type of the way the management, the intensity of the pain, how we will do, will deal with the pain, how can he handle it, how can either preoperatively, intraoperatively, or postoperatively. Epidural catheter is inserted in the theater, most probably before the induction of anesthesia, under complete aseptic non-touch technique. The patient is returned to the ward with epidural running for, following a period of monitoring in the recovery to establish the stability of hemodynamic stability of the patients and verifications of the position of the catheter. After we transfer the patients to the wards, we have to do a clinical observation. Clinical observation of the vital signs of the patients as regard blood pressure, pulse, respiratory rate should be recorded every 15 minutes for the first hour, every 30 minutes for the next 2 hours, hourly until 24 hours postoperatively, every 2 hours until the epidural analgesia ceased. Usually we use the epidural catheters for postoperative if we have a training nurses to deal with or the anesthetist available to treat the patients and give the infusions and follow up it in the wards, we can leave it for 3 days according to the intensity of the pain and according to the patient's condition. And this can be used only in also in labor. In labor, pain can be introduced, but we now talk about the acute pain. Motor power and sensory observations were must be monitored as hourly from the first 2 hours, then 4 hour, hours until epidural is removed, or more frequent if epidural rate is changed or clinically indicated. If the epidural infusion rate is increased, I have to stay with the patients and recording every 30 minutes for the vital signs for further hour to ensure the patient is in a stable condition. If I give an extra pulse dose to by the anesthetist, observation must be recorded every 5 minutes. I don't have to leave the patients at all before 20 minutes. I have stayed close to the patients for the 20 minutes after the administration of the pulse. We observe for signs of local anesthetic toxicity. A patient can be nursed sitting in a sitting up position and should be immobilized with assistance unless contraindicated by the type of the surgery he is doing, performed. Patients should be seated on a ward in such a way that allows close supervision by the staff, either in a high dependency unit or in our separate room that can be nurses can be dealing with. Care of the infusion must be recognized and completely aseptic technique. They must be labeled with a certain color. If there is a certain thing, it is an epidural infusion, not to be misunderstood. Drug errors must be monitored. What they must be, the pharmacists or the anesthetists who must prepare the infusions and give it by himself to the patients. Pump occlusion may be a complication during the procedure of giving the patients by air or occlusion bar somehow. We have to follow if it is going well or there's some obstruction. Also, we have to care about the dressing. The dressing what must be secured, the clamp must be secured with a locket catheter clamp covered with clear occlusive dressing so we can see any blood or any fluid or exudate leaking under the dressing. It must be observed daily for signs of bleeding or infection, just inflammation or swelling on tenderness or exudate. For for more of the castor, an antiseptic and aseptic, non-not touch technique must be used if the patient is under anticoagulants or receiving heparin or low molecular weight heparin. We must postpone the removal of the catheter until 10 to 12 hours after the last heparin or anticoagulants administration or given. The catheter tip should be examined to ensure that the catheter removed is complete. After we remove the catheter, we may, if there is infection, we have to make a culture and sensitivity for the tip of the catheter to put or give the patients the appropriate antibiotic for the treatment of infection. We have to observe the complications and side effects which may happen during the epidural administration. Inadequate analgesia, we must re-evaluate the regimen we put, the drugs we prepared. If you use local anesthetics alone or use local anesthetics with opioids, we have to change it. Hypotension will be, there is decrease in the blood pressure, will be treated by 250 milliliter of fluids. And re-evaluation of the patients. We have to check the respiratory depressions and the saturation of the patients all through while he is administering the local anesthetics or the epidural solution. Nausea and vomiting can be treated with anti-emetic drugs. It is usually due to the use of narcotics intrathecally. Such a complaint may be together with a pruritus. Pruritus will be treated by naloxone, which is the best line of treatment for such patients. The patients may have a linear retention, but in certain circumstances, the old patients may use urinary catheters. If not, we have to follow the patients for urinary retention and ask him if he void urine position. For epidural, we have to check if there is a prolongation of the blocks or residual motor block. If the patients received epidural with the spinal, we observe for the monitoring of the motor power after 3 hours. And switch and reassess in 3 and 60 minutes. If power and sensation improve, recommence epidural and proceed with no harm. Continue to monitor for further hour. If power remains at 2 or less, continue infusion at prescribed rates. If the patient does not receive a spinal, he has no spinal, the monitoring will be less than 3 hours postoperatively. If the motor power is still weak, we switch off the epidural and observe and reassess in 30 to 60 minutes. No return of power, reassess in another hour. If no improvements, call the anesthetist or the neurological examination and consider possibility or migration of the epidural catheter to the intrathecal space or given a spinal bolus. Note the sensory level and continue to reassess. If no improvements, we have to arrange for MRI scan to exclude hematoma and epidural compression. Another concern of the epidural is the local anesthetic toxicity. The patients may complain of a toxic dose of the local anesthetics used. First, we have to recognize how the patient is in toxicity. Sudden alteration in the mental status of the patients with severe agitation, loss of consciousness with or without tonic or colonic or even ventricular tachyarrhythmia will occur. Local anesthetic toxicity may occur sometime after an initial injection. Immediate management, stop injecting the local anesthetic, call for help, maintain airway, and if necessary, rescue. If with a tracheal tube, give 100% oxygen, ensure adequate lung ventilation. Hyperventilation may be helpful by increasing the plasma pH in the presence of metabolic acidosis. Confirm or establish intravenous access. control seizures by giving benzodiazepines, thiobentel, or propofol in small incremental doses. Assess the cardiovascular status throughout. Consider drawing blood for analysis to confirm the diagnosis, but don't delay the treatments to do such procedure. In the case of cerebellar arrest, we will do CPR for the patients. We manage arrhythmia according the protocols. We consider the cardiopulmonary bypass if available. For safe practice recommendations, we have to prepare our infusions, outsource their preparations, store epidural and IV solutions in separate locations when epidural solutions are used in the clinical area. Keep them in a specific area that's been identified for their storage, clearly label solutions with labels that states for epidural use only in the front. Use color and design to help differentiate epidural solutions for intravenous solutions. Use yellow lined tubing without injection ports for epidural administration to prevent the miss injection by IV medications or something. We hang the epidural solutions so the label can be read. We have to monitor the patients and guard against the adverse reactions to epidural analgesia. Be aware of the protocol management adverse reactions that may occur. For the safe management of the word-based epidural analgesia, we have to take informed consent of the patients and make the patient sharing with us for the management or for his case. Careful selection based on risk-benefit analysis and absence of contraindications. The regimen, we have to use a trial technique, a standard pharmacology prepared for commercially produced low-dose local anesthetics with opioid infusion. Bupivacaine, about 8 to 12 milligram per hour, plus fentanyl, 2 to 4 microgram per milliliter, or morphine can be used. Standard infusion pump, PCA, epidural facility can be used. Bacterial filter, transparent dressings. Staff must be trained. There is a nurse. Registered nurse must be available with the patients to manage his case. Particular attention to the patients and recognition and management of complications, including hypotension, respiratory depression, inadequate analgesia or motor blockades, concurrent thromboprophylaxis and anticoagulant therapy, assist the two members of acute pain team. Or the anesthetist all through the 24 hours. Monitoring must be done regarding the pain scores, the cardiovascular respiratory parameters, the sedation score, dermatomal level, and motor blockades. Daily inspections of the epidural sites, twice daily review by the acute pain team or the anesthetist. Audit and feedback to anesthetist and surgeon and the nurses. And the clinical incident reports, if any complications has happened, we must report it for the improvement. Take home message, it is that our postoperative care management, it is also, always started preoperatively. Multimodal analgesia is the best recommended line of treatment for the surgical acute pain management postoperatively. Proper preoperative pain management is a cornerstone to prevent the chronic pain. As regards nausea and vomiting, which is the two major complications that occur postoperatively, we have to decrease and reduce the baseline risk of nausea and vomiting and to adjust the patient's outcome. For the care of the epidural catheter, we require an establishment of the policies and the protocols among healthcare providers, sharing the patients with the treatment and the dealing with the catheter. Your anesthetic plan must consider modulation and the prevention of post-operative complications from the start. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Khalda, for this lovely presentation. It's very conclusive, and it covers a lot of topics and subjects that can be discussed by its own. We have a few questions for you, Dr. Khalda. One of them is talking about the garnisterone. Is it available to be used in a child less than 2 years for control of postoperative nausea and vomiting?
For a children?
Yes.
I don't think the dancitrone will be given for children.
That's the general recommendation. It's garnisterone not to be used below two under 2 years, age of 2 years. But you know, in children we have a lot of off-label use of many drugs. Like dexmedetomidine is not labeled for use in children, but people are still using it.
Can be used dexmedetomidine safely, no problem. But granny, no problem.
Yeah. And for Dr. Khalda as well, there is a question about the mechanism of action of dexamethasone in postoperative nausea and vomiting. Is there any absolute mechanism of action?
I think it is anti-inflammatory effects, and it's maybe has a role and brain stabilization and something like that. It is maybe has a role in brain stabilization and the blocking of receptors.
That's perfect. I have a question for myself. Is about your practice for postoperative nausea and vomiting. Itself, is there any medication you'd prefer to give it, like to keep it, like not as a prophylaxis, but just to keep it in the chart for a patient to be given as the treatment rather than to be prophylaxis?
A rescue medication, because as a rescue medication.
Yes.
I think granisterone is a good anti-inflammatory. We have preserved it. Lately, and starting with ondansetrone and dexamethasone and something like that from the pre and the intra, and they preserve the granisetrone lately. Metoclopramide also can be used early. I don't preserve it for the late. I preserve granisetrone for the rescue medication.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Dr. Khalda. I have a question for Dr. Hani Dahabi as well. There is a question about asking for sedation for a short procedures, like as a dental procedures. Is there any specific criteria for the pre-medication you would use?
Okay, dental procedures, apart from those for, you know, dental clearance for cardiac surgery, because you have to be more cautious in dealing with these patients, regular dental procedures, I prefer to use distraction coping procedure like mobile phone games, keep them playing and let her sit on the chair and then apply the with the holding the child, and then we ask him to inhale sevoflurane. Distraction is, I think, the best. If I personally would use and have enough time, I would give dexmedetomidine 4 mics per kg early, maybe at least 45 minutes before induction of anesthesia.
Thank you very much for that. That will conclude all our questions for today. Dr. Saad, if you have anything to add as well.
I'm so grateful to all top speakers tonight, Prof. Samir Ansari, Prof. Hani Zahbi, and Prof. Khalda Radwan, and to my excellent colleagues as a moderator, Dr. Amr Hilal and Dr. Amr Salam. And that's the beauty of the MEGA. Dr. Amr Hilal and Dr. Amr Salam are very close friends together, and they are from the same university, Ain Shams University, under the same leaders, Prof. Hani Zahbi and Prof. Samir Ansari. All from on your behalf, I would like to thank all our attendees tonight and for their support. More than 200 people staying with us.